When we reached the 200th anniversary of the institution in its present form, we confronted ourselves with the challenge. What do we intend to do with this great and mighty instrument which God has placed in our hands? Well, first of all, I think we have to stop the rot. We have to restore the faith to its proper place, and we have to assist our churches in bringing back the wandering to the fold. Our chaplains, of course, have a vital role in all of this, and they're discharging that very well. But we, the laymen, have a vital role as well. And first of all, we've got to get rid of this silly notion that a layman who quotes scriptures or offers prayers is somehow distinctly odd. And there's no justification for that notion, because our preceptories, their monthly meetings, are engaged in acts of worship. The degrees themselves are classes of instruction. So my challenge to all my comrades, friends throughout the world, is to sally forth from our preceptory rooms and share the faith with the entire human race.
From its uncertain origins in 1797, the Royal Black Institution now celebrates its bicentenary with confidence and the support of up to 50,000 members in over 10 different jurisdictions around the world. The early years of the Royal Black Institution are shrouded in mystery, though it may be said for certain that its founders came from the same locality as those who created the Orange Institution, and that it is of nearly the same age. Ireland in the late 18th century was a scene of great civil and social unrest. Many small secret societies were founded throughout the length and breadth of the island by people fearful for the survival of their communities, culture and traditions, and general way of life. The memory of William, Prince of Orange, was held dear by Protestants throughout the British Isles during the 18th century. Many of the secret societies and clubs formed in Ireland not only aimed to protect and preserve their communities, but also to celebrate the events of the Glorious Revolution, the Act of Settlement, and the establishment of the Protestant ascendancy. Societies such as the Constitutional Club of Gentlemen of the County of Kerry, the County of Mayo Club, the Aldermen of Skinner's Alley, the Royal Boyne Society, and of course, the Orange Order. It was out of this time of strife and great unrest that both the Orange and Black institutions were founded, as organizations pledged to the defense of their homesteads and communities. The spread of the Orange was rapid throughout the county, the spread of the Black less so. By 1797, a meeting of delegates in Portadown on the 12th of July was so well attended that it was decided to form a Grand Orange Lodge, and that warrants would be printed and awarded to new lodges in almost every county in Ireland. 1798 was the year of the rebellion of the United Irishmen. Presbyterians and Roman Catholics in Ireland alike suffered under the penal laws and rose together to seek emancipation. Much of their inspiration to act came from the American War of Independence of 1779 and the French Revolution of 1789. The original members of the Orange and Black institutions were mostly Church of Ireland, the established church, and they greatly feared the threat the United Irishmen posed to their allegiance to the crown. The threat of invasion by French forces in support of the rebellion added to their fears and gave great impetus to the spread of the Orange Order in particular. Many Orangemen fought and distinguished themselves on the government side and played a vital role in the crushing of the rebellion. In those early years, the formation of Black lodges lacked the organization and widespread support of their Orange counterparts. Black lodges also tended to be more isolated from one another and much more secretive. Indeed, during the early part of the 19th century, the Orange tried to discourage membership of any other orders. However, by 1820, the Black Order adopted a government of sorts of its own, had formed its own Grand Lodge to issue warrants, and was clearly independent and distinct from the authority of the Orange. But just as it appeared to be gaining strength and purpose, the Black Order found itself driven underground by a series of laws designed to wipe out secret societies throughout the British Isles. Some historians of the Black have labelled the next two decades as the dark years for the Order. Not much is known about the few lodges who continued to meet. All attempts to maintain an overall governing body collapsed, and further pressure was brought to bear by the major parliamentary inquiry of 1835 into the Grand Orange Lodge. However, after this inquiry, events took a peculiar and most unusual turn. A Glasgow-based organisation calling itself the Knights of Malta took upon itself the title of the Parent Grand Black Lodge of the Universe, claiming the power to issue warrants and confer degrees. It seems that these Knights of Malta were not inheritors of the title conferred on the Crusaders of the 10th and 11th centuries, but rather a group of men from County Tyrone who had taken refuge in Glasgow and formed themselves into an order. A number of black lodges in Ireland, lacking any local leadership, gave their allegiance to the Knights. The year 1846 was to prove vital to the history of the Black Order in Ireland. A few black brethren in County Armagh decided to try to bring to an end this period of confusion and disorder. They wrote to as many black lodges as they could trace and invited them to send representatives to a meeting in Portadown on the 14th of September with a view to discussing the subject of amalgamation. This meeting was the turning point. Agreement was made to reconstitute the Grand Black Chapter of Ireland, and this organisation gradually began the process of bringing under its umbrella all the black lodges throughout the British Isles to create what has been called a fully disciplined, dignified and powerful bulwark of Protestantism throughout the English-speaking world. The principles laid down in 1846 have largely guided the black ever since, and remain the solid base on which the institution thrives today. It is not political, except insofar as it owes its allegiance to the British Crown, to the Protestant establishment, and to its preservation in the British Constitution. Otherwise, political matters are not discussed at black meetings. Rather, the institution holds dear the principles of good Christian values, public witness and worship.
Black institution is very, very interesting, I think, to most people who take the trouble, and get many of them are taking the trouble, thankfully, to study the scriptures connected with the various degrees, and we're taking steps to ensure that they have some idea about that before they even become members. So in its personal relationship to me, I think the more one studies those portions of scripture, even the pictures and the banners, the more you understand and the more you're able to put in context present-day affairs and even present-day problems. And that's a great consolation.
Almighty and all-gracious One, we bow before Thee this Sabbath afternoon to worship, to adore, and to magnify Thy great and holy name. We come before Thee as Thy creatures, acknowledging that Thou art indeed the Creator of all, Now the great God of the universe has called all into being, and thou sustainest and supportest all life. We indeed acknowledge that it is thou that hast made us and not we ourselves, and we adore and magnify thee, our Creator God.
I still believe that with the degrees that we have in the black and the what it teaches us, that when men become involved, they will grasp the light that these degrees teach us and explain to us in our Protestant beliefs and our teachings of from the Bible. I think that the men will still be wanting to be members of our organization.
I believe that in the secularized age in which we live, the black institution has a great part to play because it involves men of all denominations in the Protestant Reformed Evangelical faith. We don't come as members of congregations, we come as a brotherhood of fellowship under the guidance of the gospel to extend that gospel in our day and generation, and especially in here in Northern Ireland, amid all the confusion and trauma of our times.
And once again the scene was changed, new earth there seemed to be. I saw the holy city beside the tideless sea. The light of God was on its streets, the gates were
is very important indeed. I try to live by the principles of the Word of God and the principles laid down by the Royal Black Institution, which of course is based on Holy Scripture.
And Joseph said to his brothers, I am about to die, but God will assist you and bring you out of this land, which he swore to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob.
I joined the institution because I knew that within the precepts of it there was a deeper understanding of scriptural and spiritual truths. And from my understanding of the institution as an outsider, I knew that those truths were based right from the very beginning of Scripture, from man's fall, Garden of Eden, right through to the finished work of Christ on Calvary, right on through to the preparation of the new heaven, the new earth, and the new Jerusalem, which was a pattern, a simple but a very profound pattern to show the eternal truths of Scripture.
Based on these solid foundations of Christian faith, the influence of the Royal Black Institution soon spread throughout the British Empire to become a Grand Imperial Order of the British Commonwealth, and indeed many of the jurisdictions from around the world were represented at the bicentenary celebrations. Now faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen, for by it the men of old received divine approval. By faith, we understand that the world was created by the Word of God, so that what is seen was made out of things which do not appear.
My faith is, though within me, my actions, my way of talking and all the rest, reveal that Christ is the only mediator between man and God. And the open Bible, therefore, as we have taken strong faith in this.
The aims of the institution in New Zealand, I guess, are much the same as anywhere in the world. We aim to make better citizens of ourselves and to reinforce Protestant faith and to encourage men to learn more about the scriptures. And I think these things remain important no matter what millennium you're in, but they're certainly a little bit harder to sell to the younger people today.
The Royal Black Institution has a tremendous impact in so many people's lives. It's an institution for good. It's a very, very magnanimous institution. Its teachings are based on the Holy Bible, and no matter what millennium anyone is in, that truth still holds good. So that in the Royal Black Institution, the respective lessons which we get from the various degrees, such as fidelity, such as faith, such as humility, sincerity, truthfulness, charity, all those are very, very magnanimous lessons. Commissions which each individual has within the Royal Black Institution, those are bound to hold good in any millennium. But I think that it's got to hold good within the Royal Black Institution, and it's a source for good in the future.
The Black Institution, of course, is an upholder of the Reformed faith, and therefore, as a member, should I need support, and should at any time I feel a little bit low, then the Black Institution helps me immensely to, you know, recover my spirit.
And David said, "The Lord who delivered me from the paw of the lion and from the paw of the bear will deliver me from the hand of this Philistine." And Saul said to David, "Go, and the Lord be with you."
Faith brought me through, right up through the Batcan, the Battle of the Bulge, the Farley's Gap, up into the Ardennes, and I finished up in Hamburg, Hermann Göring Barracks. And then once I came back for a short leave, and then I went back overseas to the Middle East. We dropped off 3,000 prisoners of war in Italy. They were reprieved then, and I went to have a 2 years in the Middle East. So my faith has brought me that far. And at my age now, still, we deny ourselves the fact that we say a little prayer for ourselves every day, unconsciously, you know.
Stand, therefore, having girded your loins with truth, and having put on the breastplate of righteousness, and having shod your feet with the equipment of the gospel of peace. Besides all these, taking the shield of faith, with which you can quench all the flaming darts of the evil one. And take the helmet of salvation, and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God.
Skorva is a family day, and you really cannot go to Skorva and not feel as if you belong to the greater family. Not just the family of, you know, of loyal Ulster people, but there's a fraternity, a fellowship. You don't have to know their names, you don't have to know people personally, but there's a sense of belonging, and this is what you find at Skorva. And indeed, I was at Skorva yesterday, and there were more than 80,000 people gathered together. It was a wonderful event, you know, after the trauma of the last few days and weeks.
Thank you.
I found the gathering at Scava one of the most amazing experiences of my life. I have never seen anything like it before, and it just was truly mind-blowing. The number of brethren on parade and the size of the crowd, but also the banners. We don't have banners like that in New Zealand. I don't know whether it's the distance from Britain where they make them or the expense, but I've never seen so many banners on display in my life, so that was really impressive.
On the 9th of November, 1838, it is recorded that the Tandragee Preceptory had 27 members. The worshipful master was George Whitten and the deputy master, James Mason. The membership soon expanded, being drawn from the districts of Points Pass, Scarva, Guildford and Clare, as well as Tandragee. They used to walk to meet each other on the way to Scarva, where the sham fight was lawfully accepted on the 13th of July, 1838. Prior to that date, the sham fight had unlawfully been held on different dates. In 1836 in Scarva, they'd been dispersed by military in great force.
My Lord, we cherish your leadership. We thank you for your stand that you have taken down the many years. Through the whole troubles of Northern Ireland, you led us in a dignified and brave manner. And to mark your elevation to the House of Lords, my county decided that we should mark this occasion and present you with a painting. I would ask you now if you would just follow me slightly to my right, and I will make that presentation to you now. Thank you.
God, we give you thanks for the great things that you have done for us in the past. But above all, we thank you for sending your Son, Jesus Christ, into the world to be our Savior. We thank you for the love that sent him down to this earth, that those who call upon him might be saved. We thank you too, dear Lord, for all your guidance and providence in the years that have passed. We thank you for leading our institution over the past 200 years, and we pray that you will encourage and help us to go forward into the next century with your hand upon us and guiding us in all that we seek to do. We ask for your blessings on our proceedings here today. We pray that you will be with us, that you will guide our words and our actions, and that we may bring everything to your honour and to your glory. Bless every member of the Royal Black Institution throughout the world. We give you thanks for our overseas members who have gathered with us here today. We thank you for the witness of the Royal Black Institution in other parts of the world. And we pray that as we continue to witness for you, that your name may be glorified and that others may be brought into your kingdom through our witness.
on this 200th anniversary of the Royal Black Institution in its present form, we renew our obligation to defend and extend the Christian faith based on the teachings of Holy Scripture. We dedicate ourselves to a crusade to re-establish true religion, which is the only sure foundation for all human relationships.
To come over here for the first time for me is just something else. I have been absolutely thrilled to first of all be in Northern Ireland, and secondly to have actually been part of the proceedings here. It will be something that I will take away and remember for the rest of my life. I'm very eagerly looking forward to the proceedings of the forthcoming weekend. The Scarpa demonstration was something else. To be part of all this, it's a tremendous thrill. Unless you actually come over here, where the heart of the whole thing is, I don't think you can get a real appreciation of it. We don't go in back home for bowler hats and things like that. It's always been a source of intrigue to me to see the brethren marching, the way they're decked out, to be actually with them. Whether I'm wearing a bowler hat or not is a tremendous thrill to me. I know it is to my compatriots who've been marching here as well.
The resolution which, as a member of Her Majesty's Privy Council, I am privileged to put before you reads as follows. We, the representatives of the nations of the Commonwealth of which the Queen is head, bring loyal greetings to Her Majesty from the lands wherein we dwell. We affirm our pledge of true allegiance to our Sovereign Lady, who has guided and moulded our Commonwealth into an institution of lasting benefit to all mankind.
The annual sham fight and day out at Scarba in County Down is a vital part of the tradition of the Imperial Grand Black Chapter of the British Commonwealth. But its headquarters are at Brownlow House in Lurgan, County Armagh. Even though the building suffered considerable damage during an arson attack in 1995, Brownlow House is now undergoing a period of extensive renovation, which will eventually restore it to its former grandeur. Not only does it serve as an imposing setting for various ceremonial occasions, but it's also the vitally important planning and operational centre where such major events as the bicentennial celebrations are meticulously orchestrated. One of the main highlights of this period of celebration for the Imperial Grand Black Chapter of the British Commonwealth was a grand bicentenary banquet held in the magnificent surroundings of the City Hall in Belfast and attended by dignitaries from both home and abroad.
Sovereign Grand Master, it is indeed, as I said, an honor and a privilege to propose a toast to an institution that is celebrating its bicentenary. For any organization or institution to exist for over 200 years, I think speaks well not only for the leadership of that institution, but the fabric of the membership that makes up that institution. As a visitor to this fair country and part of the Commonwealth, I know that this institution is important here as it is throughout the whole of the Commonwealth. It's an integral part of all of our lives, and we pay deepest respect to that organization. I would ask you now if you would please stand with me and drink a toast to the Imperial Grand Black Chapter of the British Commonwealth. Here.
Privilege and a great help to be seated beside my friend and colleague, the Imperial Grand Treasurer of the World Orange Council, because now he's the man with the money. And he was invited to propose the toast, for which I thank him very much. But now that I have retired and fallen on hard times, our friendship will come in very, very useful indeed. The greater number here tonight represent the basic units of our organization, preceptories, districts, counties, provincial chapters, and had it not been for their outstanding devotion and all of that time those who have gone before, we would not, as an institution, stand poised as we do tonight to adventure into our third century and the world's third millennium. I trust, ladies and gentlemen, it will encourage them and all our friends to learn that while we adhere to the just doctrine of the justification by faith alone, we find no great contradiction in Browning's verse, "All service ranks the same with God, with him there is no last nor first." Nor are we unmindful of the definition that service is the rent we pay for our stay here on earth. And finally, all of you will have sensed, taking part in the deliberations in the World Orange Council at Scarva on Monday and in here in the Grand Chapter today and this gathering here, whether you're members of the institution or not, you will be conscious that we're facing the fact that great opportunities now lie before us with matching responsibilities. In other words, to whom much has been given, from him much will be required. Ladies and gentlemen, we will not be found wanting. Thank you very much.
As we approach a new millennium, we must face the future with confidence. A confidence that is built on the sure foundation of what has been given to us by our forefathers. A confidence that is based on a shared vision of the future. And a confidence that is derived from teamwork, everyone working towards a common goal. Most Worshipful Sovereign Grand Master, Sir Knights, sisters and brethren, I am convinced that we who have had the honor and the privilege to celebrate this important occasion clearly understand the task ahead, but I am equally confident that together we will succeed. Sir Knights of the Imperial Grand Black Chapter, I ask you to stand and to honor the toast of our guests. Thank you.
Our guests. Yes.
We are determined that our voices will be heard as one in what are our immediate and future concerns. We will work for a peaceful and prosperous Northern Ireland, but not at any price. As I speak for the officers and members of the Imperial Orange Council of the World, I know they will take back to their own jurisdictions a very happy memory of tonight in the Belfast City Hall. We thank you most sincerely and fraternally for for your great kindness to us all. It is an unforgettable experience, and I thank you on behalf of all our guests. Thank you very much.
Pretty maiden, good night.
As the Royal Black Institution celebrates 200 years of history and achievement and looks forward to the new millennium with pride, confidence and hope, the basic values on which it was founded remain true and firm in these unsettling and uncertain times. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore we will not fear though the earth should change, though the mountains shake in the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam, though the mountains tremble with its tumult.
I'm quite confident that the institution is now well geared and equipped to enter on not only a new century, its third century in its present form, but the millennium as well. And I am absolutely convinced that the Black Institution is going to make a very big mark internationally for the benefit of all mankind.
As we look back with thanksgiving for 200 years of devoted service under the guidance of what we call the Living Christ, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, we are now planning to go forth with that same gospel into the days ahead to be a reviving influence, especially here in our province at this time, as it were, to be an extension of the Christian Church in the problems and perplexities that daily beset us, looking forward to the day when peace and prosperity will come to this province we all love so well.
I would be saying to young people who would come along and want to join, delighted, first of all, to hear that you're interested in joining, but secondly, can commend it very, very highly with any sense of compunction whatsoever. I can speak out and say you're joining a very fine institution, a wonderful institution, delighted to have you if you are the right caliber too, because the Royal Black Institution is an institution which, as it were, screens those people who come into it. And we don't wish to take anybody in who is somebody whose sense of responsibility is not what it should be, either as a citizen or as a relative within a family. And therefore it's very important that the right caliber of individual comes in. And if a good, sensible, responsible, respectable young person says, I wish to join the institution, then I would be saying, do come along. You will find it very, very well worthwhile.
I have made many friends through the Royal Black Institution. I believe that the institution has a lot to offer people in terms of culture and in terms of fellowship and indeed instruction. I would look back upon my membership of that institution that it has contributed to me a tremendous vision for the future. And that vision is that I would see members of our beloved institution getting back to the old-time things of God, that we would remember all the way that the Lord has led us throughout these years. And as the old hymn writer said, that the God who is our help in ages past is the God who is our hope for years to come, and the God who is the shelter within that rock of ages for all of eternity.
Oh,
all members must support and promote the Protestant religion. All must support and defend Her Present Majesty the Queen, her heirs and successors being Protestant. All must conduct themselves as loyal subjects of the Constitution of Great Britain and Northern Ireland. All must at all times uphold the honour of brother Sir Knights, and all must conduct themselves with honour and sobriety. By adhering to these basic tenets, all members of the Royal Black Institution create an organization which prides itself in its Protestantism, its loyalty, its sense of brotherhood, and its good works. Each member is an ambassador for these guiding principles which embody good Christian values and public witness.
Grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, the communion and fellowship of the Holy Spirit, rest and abide with each one of us, all whom we love, near and far, this day and forevermore. Amen.